Have you ever had this happen? You're making a level that's based on a bunch of tiles or modular pieces, and you roll the ball over these tiles, and then the ball just goes flying off in some random direction? Yeah, I had that happen when I was making this mini golf micro game. You're pretty much guaranteed to have that happen in this scenario because of how the physics engine works. In this video, we're going to take a look at how we can solve that problem in two different ways. Number one, the quick and easy, dirty, hacky solution that you probably shouldn't really use, but it'll get you going. And number two, a more complex way that gets you a lot of control, but you gotta do a little bit of work to get there. The second option is a lot more scalable, and if you're gonna go into production with a game, I'd recommend taking a look at that one. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy. Here to help you.
Who, me?
Yes, you. Make your game dev dream become a reality by making you a master of realistic physics. That's probably an overstatement, maybe just helping you get rid of the ghost bounces. In my free and open source mini golf micro game, I ran into this problem because I was building out the level based on the tile map. So I have a bunch of 1x1 cubes placed right next to each other, and whenever the ball started rolling over them, it would just fly out and go in some random direction constantly. It was a huge pain point. It took me the longest to solve this than the entire rest of the game. And it didn't really make sense because it was a totally flat plane. So it took me a lot of research to figure out exactly what's going on there. And to solve the problem, we first need to know, why does it happen? And if you want me to dive really deep into the rigid body and all the aspects of how that works, let me know in the comments. Suffice to say for this conversation that it doesn't really matter which values you choose for interpolation. Collision detection of continuous or continuous dynamic are the two that you'd want to use to get you the most accurate physics, and it still happens in those cases. So let's just assume you're using continuous, and you have a reasonable interpolation value for whatever your use case is. I set mine to none. The physics system, much like the rest of the engine, works on a series of snapshots. We can think of them like frames. It's decoupled from the rendering frame, but we have a fixed time step on the physics system, and we interpolate from point A to point B, or do a sweep, is what it's called, to determine if we hit something moving from point A to point B. Now, if we have a collider, or two colliders, with a seam in between there, and we go from A to B, sometimes the physics system will incorrectly assume that seam would be a hit on a corner and your ball goes flying out. That's why this is happening. There's a lot more complex math that goes into it, but we can simplify it to basically that. So today we're looking at the two ways that we can address that. Number one, a hacky solution, where in our physics settings, we adjust the default contact offset to a lower value. This solves the problem, but introduces some jitter. And Unity explicitly recommends against doing this. So take that for what it's worth. The second option is we can discard unwanted contacts before the physics system receives those contact points and say, hey, don't worry about it, or smooth out that bump. That one naturally is a much better solution. So make sure that you stick around until we hit that point. Let's dive in and check these out. In our scene, we can see that we've got some grass and some sand. I've done some mesh combination here, which helps prevent a lot of the problem. But anytime we have a seam from one object to another object, we are pretty likely, especially moving at higher velocities, to run into this ghost collision. Yes, even with our ball at continuous dynamic, regardless of your interpolation, you will run into this problem. So I'm gonna cover the mesh combination, how exactly that works, in another video. Depending on when you watch, you may have a card on your screen and the link may be in the description. So most likely we will never see a ghost collision on any of the sand, but as we transition from the grass to the sand or the sand to the grass, that's where we're more likely to hit this. Let's go ahead and give it a shot, move it quickly, and there we go. We made a ghost collision as we transition from the sand to the grass, even though it's totally flat. So if we want to avoid this, the hacky solution, which is actually what I shipped the game with initially, is if you go to Project Settings, Physics, Settings, Game Object, we've got a default contact offset. We can see that there's a little bit of a warning here that we don't want to get too close to zero, and this default value of 0.01 is supposed to be a really good value. However, to solve this particular problem, if we add in a zero there, save it and click play again, you're going to see that this is a much harder thing to reproduce now. So just lowering the default contact offset makes it significantly less likely to run into one of these ghost collisions. But we do see there was a little bit of jitter there. At maximum speed, we can see that jitter that Unity is telling us may occur. But our ghost collisions are solved. So that's my hack solution. If you just want to do something, you don't want to encode, you don't care about anything, just add the zero here and that works. For this use case, it may cause other problems in your game, and Unity actually discourages us from modifying this value. But that is one solution. So if we set this back to the default 0.01 and let's click play again, If we take a look at our ball, we'll see that we have a ball script here, and it has a settled velocity and a bounce prevention mode. If we set that to simple, keep in mind our 0.01 default contact offset, you're gonna see that we still don't encounter this problem, and there's no jitter. So this is a much more robust solution. Let's take a look at how that works. Initially, I only had this ball here so we could count when the rigid body had stopped moving and raise an event that the ball had settled, and that would count as a stroke at that time. And we'd re-enable the player input so we can putt the ball again. Now, however, you're going to see that we assign a delegate handler to the contact modify event CCD. We want to use the modify event CCD because we're using continuous collision detection. If your rigid body is set up to not use continuous collision detection, then you can use the contact modify event without the CCD suffix. This contact modify event allows us to manipulate the modifiable contact pairs that are provided in the second argument here based on whatever logic we want to provide. And you'll notice, since it's a native array of modifiable contact pairs, that means that it's using the job system and we can schedule jobs to do this work. Now, because I'm using very simple code here, I didn't really need to jobify it. But if you need to do something more complex than the simple thing we're about to cover, you can schedule your own jobs and schedule them to be completed in the fixed update. So what I'm doing is finding all of the modifiable contact pairs that interact with this rigid body. So we've got the contact pair collider instance ID and the rigid body collider instance ID. We grab that collider instance ID on awake. And if we have set our bounce prevention mode to simple, all we're doing here is iterating over all of those, checking if our separation is greater than zero. And what that means is if the distance between our two contact pairs, so the collider and our rigid body, is greater than zero, meaning they have some separation, and what we'll do is override the normal of this contact pair to be the world up. What this does is override that normal because we're hitting the corner of the next object. And that's where we get the bump, because the physics system is incorrectly calculating that we hit the corner of the next object. And we want to smooth that out and say, no, it's not actually a bump. We're not hitting the corner. This is a smooth plane. Now, this works for my particular use case, but you can use whatever logic you want to use here to override things like even the separation, the normal, basically anything in here on our contact pair, we can override. So this is a simple implementation of a callback on contact modify event, but depending on your particular use case, you may need to do something more complex here, and that's fine. You can even do pretty complex stuff since we can jobify whatever we need to do here because we get the modifiable contact pairs as a native array. I found out about this API because Peter from Sunny Valley Studios sent me a YouTube video from Unity covering how you can modify these contact pairs. I've got a link to Sunny Valley Studios YouTube and that video that helped me get this working a much more robust way than just hacking our default contact offset. So huge shout out to Peter helping me not teach you just a hacky way to solve this problem. If you've stuck around in this video this long, I've got a surprise for you. There's actually three ways that we can address this. If you use the Havoc physics package instead of the default Unity physics, they have an out-of-the-box way to help you solve this problem. They have a feature called contact point welding. And if you turn this on for the specific objects that you're interested in, Havoc will automatically, based on your scene and what you've marked for contact point welding, it'll eliminate those ghost collisions by doing some fancy stuff under the hood. They don't tell us exactly how it works, but something similar to what we did today. Probably much more complex and robust than the specific use case solving that I did. I understand Havoc physics, not everybody's using it, but this is an out-of-the-box solution I still thought was worth mentioning in this video. I hope this video helped you solve the ghost collision problem, understand why it happens, and gave you the tools you need to solve it for your game. If you got value out of this video, make sure you've liked and subscribed to help the channel grow, reach more people, and add value to more people. And if I can ask a favor from you, could you share this out with somebody you think would get value out of it too? That helps me a lot, and I know it's gonna help somebody that you know as well. And if you wanted to show your support for the channel, there's a few ways that you can do that. You can get yourself some LlamAcademy merch at the merch store right here on YouTube. You can use the affiliate links down in the description to do your Humble Bundle and the Unity Asset Store shopping. It gives me a small percentage of the purchase price at no additional charge to you. Or you can become a YouTube member or Patreon supporter. Your recurring monthly contribution there helps me out way more than watching even 1,000 videos. It's amazing how helpful that is. All the tiers get access to a private members exclusive Discord where you'll get direct access to me. You can ask questions, get priority support. And starting at the awesome tier, you'll get a shout out at the end of every video, like Ivan, Ifiobolus, Perry, and Mustafa. At the supporter tier and higher, you get your name on every single repository and your name up here at the end of every video. Thank you to everyone who's supporting me on Patreon and YouTube. I am so incredibly grateful.